Once we get that going, I'm going to share my screen. And when we go live, I just want to allow a couple people to come on. So I'm going to share my screen now. And yeah, we are live on our platforms. So let me bring that up. I'm just going to play some music while we let people come in.
Yeah, sending this one out to my man Killer B. No doubt, indeed. But that we, you know what I'm saying? That old real shit. There's a war going on outside, no man is safe from. You could run, but you can't hide forever from these streets that we done took. You walking with your head down, scared to look. You shook, cause ain't no such things as halfway crooks. They never around when the beef cooks in my part of town. It's similar to Vietnam. Now we all grown up and old and beyond the cops' control. They better have the riot gear ready, trying to back me and get rock steady. Mac one double, I touch you and leave you with not much to go home with. My skin is thick, cause I'll be up in the mix of action. If I'm not at home, puffin' live, relaxing. New York got a nigga depressed, so I wear a slug proof underneath my gifts. God bless my soul before I pull my foot down and begin to stroll into the drama I built. And all unfinished beef, you will soon be killed. Put us together, it's like mixing vodka and milk. I'm going out blasting and taking my enemies with me. And if not, they scar, so they will never forget me. Lord, forgive me. The Hennessy got me not knowing how to act. I'm falling and I can't turn back. Or maybe it's the words from my man Killer Black that I can't say. So what's left an untold fact? Until my death, my goal is to stay alive. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive.
Yeah, yeah. We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive. We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive. We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive. We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive. I'm trapped
in between two worlds trying to get dough. You know when the dough get low, the juice go. But never that, as long as things go crack, I'll be on the block hustling, count my stacks. No doubt, watching my back and proceed with caution. 5-4 working, no time to get lost in. The system niggas using fake names to get out quick. My brother did it and got back with 2 ounces. I live with one with scars, hit the block hard. That's my man Twin when he got back. Don't fuck me up, God. But shit happens for a reason. You find out who's the true peoples when you're upstate bleeding. You can't find a shorty, the truth, the fear bitch. Hit with a 2-4 is difficult. While on the streets, I try to maintain. Tight with my Lucas hoes like to run game. Some niggas like to trip, but I ain't with that trickin' shit. I'm like a Jew, saving those who I could be with. Pushing the Lex, now I'm set, ready to check. No matter how much loot I get, I'm staying in the projects forever. Jake's on the blocks, we out clever. If beef, we never separate, go together. When worse come to worst, my people come first. Try to react and get the motherfucker feeling hurt. My crew's all about blue. Fuck looking cute. I'm strictly kill loops and army certified suits. Puff the nails, lay back, enjoy the smell. In the bridge, getting down, it ain't hard to tell. You better realize.
We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit. Still, we live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive. We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit. Only the strong survive. We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive. Still living in our lives. When your eyes get wise, look alive, let it vibe, roll it up. Hypnotic stuff like your dead ass paralyzed. You know what I'm saying? Fall deeply like.
Awesome. We're now at 6:10. And people are still going to be coming in, but I think we should go ahead and get started. Are you good, Reyes? Cool. Awesome. Thank you, guys. Thank you, everybody who's logging in right now inside our chat room. Thank you to everybody who is watching on our live streams right now off YouTube Live and also Facebook Live. We're going to go ahead and get started here and with our acknowledgement. I'm going to stop sharing my screen so we can do a little bit of a self-intro. Gwatsi se hopa, wahenome, gataya, hershat sanu koyawashi, kawait kumitsta awadu keek so'u. My name is Marcus Trujillo, and I'm from the Pueblo of Laguna, from the village of Parahi, and I'm a communications designer for the Pueblo Action Alliance. And so Yeah, I'm really excited to be co-facilitating this workshop, and I'm gonna pass it over to Reyes to give some introduction as well.
Hello everyone, my name is Reyes DeVore. I am from the Pueblo of Jemez. Our traditional name is Jemish, and our community lives in Walatoa, which translates to "this is the place." And is about 45 miles northwest of so-called Albuquerque. I currently serve as the community programming director, and I also lead our youth interns and mutual aid efforts. And thank you all for joining us this evening. Before we get into today's discussion, PAA would like to take a moment to honor the land that we are coming to you from today. We would like to pay respect and provide acknowledgement that we are in Tiwa territory. There was once 12 Tiwa-speaking villages that lived both north and south of the Rio Grande that stretches through so-called Albuquerque. The Tiwa villages fought to defend their territories in the winter of 1540 by the settler expedition of Coronado. It is important to note that the Tiwa War was the first named war between European settlers and indigenous peoples in what is now stolen land by the US Empire. Julia Bernal, our Alliance Director with PAA, is also our Sandia relative and sister who leads our EJ work and the Water Back campaign with us. Today and always, PAA honors Tiwa people and their communities as we mobilize our own Pueblo peoples in their territories. We'd also like to hear introductions from our participants, you know, by sharing your name, your pronouns, your tribal affiliations, and the territories that you all are coming in from. So please feel free to do that in the Zoom chat or comment in any of the restream and social media platforms that we're on as well. I know that we all miss, you know, gathering together, but by sharing this, it's a way that we can connect with each other while we're in this virtual space together. So yeah, please begin to start, you know, sharing that in the chat. We would like to hear where you're coming from. Also acknowledge what territory that you're coming to from us today. Thank you, Zach, coming in from Washonumi territory in so-called Nevada. Thank you. I also see another Hamish sister, Kiara Toya, representing Jemez Pueblo as well. Thank you for being here. We also have, Alexis coming in from Tiwa territory. Thank you all for being here today. And yeah, please continue to share where you are from. And let's all acknowledge whose land we're on and just remember to be respectful and honor the living peoples who are also in those territories as well. All right, go ahead, Marcus. Oh, actually, let me go ahead and screen share. I also do want to note that my computer can make me sound like a robot sometimes. So, you know, we've been trying to virtually make sure, virtually gather together, and with that comes technical difficulties. For some reason, my audio does go out. Please let me know and I will adjust that real quick. I'm gonna go ahead and screen share with you all. And can I get a thumbs up if you can see this? Thumbs up, awesome. All right, so what you're looking at right now is our homepage of our website, pueblo-action-alliance.org. Shout out to our comms team who is always updating this and making sure that this information is up to date for you all. What I'm gonna do right now is I'm gonna navigate our website for you just a little bit so that way we can also share our framework with you all as well. So I'm gonna start with about, and then go to the drop-down menu and select About Us. And it is actually going to take you to our mission and our framework and our vision, and I'm gonna go over that with you. First and foremost, we are the descendants of Pueblo revolutionaries. We acknowledge this because we know that our ancestors fought many battles for us to be here today. And, you know, we acknowledge that the PAA, the work that PAA does is more than just activism. It's life work. It's life work because we know it is our responsibility to also defend our peoples, defend our territories, and just to defend what has rightfully always been ours. And our mission, if you kind of scroll down a little bit more, kind of showcases how we get that work done. You know, we are a community-based organization that promotes cultural sustainability. And we do this by addressing all the ways that settler colonialism continues to oppress us. We address this through environmental and social impacts within not just Pueblo communities, but our indigenous communities all across Turtle Island. If we continue to scroll down, you'll also see our vision here. And in that vision, you know, we see this work as long-term work. You know, we see infrastructures being built, you know, long past like what we're doing right now. You know, it is important that for us to be liberated and for us to have like indigenous self-determination, that means we must dismantle and eradicate white supremacy, capitalism, imperialism, patriarchy, and extractive colonialism. And it's really important to note, and I want to place emphasis on this last sentence here, because the liberation of indigenous peoples is a liberation for all. And we truly believe in that. And we hope that you do the work to kind of understand what that means as well. I'm going to continue to scroll down into our 10 points of unity. So our 10 points of unity was created to make sure that we accomplished that long-term vision that I just spoke about. You know, in order to unify and mobilize our people, we must have this framework set up. You know, we have to have those strategies and tactics that are going to bring us to those points of unification, you know, to make sure that we're also protecting those values that we hold as Pueblo peoples. So right now, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna actually go down the list of all of the 10 points of unity. And these were also made because, you know, with the membership that you guys will soon be hearing about a little bit more, our Pueblo membership, we wanna make sure that all of our relatives align with these as well. So first one is to fight and protect our birthright as Pueblo indigenous people. Number two, to heal from cycles of trauma and oppression and to heal the land and waters. Number three, to create intergenerational spaces to learn and grow. Four is to preserve indigenous languages, traditional teachings, and oral his/her stories. Five, dismantle and eradicate oppressive systems and European occupations that have harmed and assimilated indigenous peoples. Number six is to build international solidarity with the indigenous global struggle. We need to remember that colonialism is not unique to this land base. Seven, to mobilize a united Pueblo front. Eight, to obtain land and water back. If you haven't checked out our water campaign, please do that. Number nine, to embrace intersectional identities by embracing the Eurocentric disease that has occupied the indigenous spirit, mind, and body. And then number 10 is to restore balance of power among people of all genders. So that was our 10 points of unity. And what I'm also going to go over is PAA's traditional core values. You know, that is definitely at the root of what we do. You know, I have so much respect for our team and the work that we do because we know and we honor all of the ways that we've been taught, you know, those traditional core values. You know, we respect when each one of us has to go participate in activities at home, and that's definitely unique, you know, because we don't always get that. And we know that those traditional core values need to be at the core of our work. And so that's also why it's built into our framework. And, you know, we also acknowledge that each of our public communities have their own traditional core values too. So this is definitely not to disrespect any core values that other public peoples have, but this is to kind of encapsulate majority of what we see within our public communities. So number one is respect. Number two, consent. Number three, protection of sacred entities. Number four is culture sustainability. Number five is community defense. And number six is indigenous self-determination and sovereignty. And then number seven is traditional popular education. And number seven is a lot of the reason why you all are here today, right? We are, you know, PAA is consistently making sure that we provide spaces of learning that is accessible and intergenerational for all of our listeners. And today what you're going to see is a presentation, not just a presentation, important truths that need to be shared. And we hope that everybody leaves this space, you know, having a deeper understanding, or, you know, begins to kind of make those connections and see how and why settler colonialism continues to hurt us as a people, but definitely across Turtle Island and Pueblo peoples. But I'm going to go ahead and let Marcus start us off.
Awesome. Thank you, Reyes, for sharing our framework here at PAA. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen as well to get the presentation rolling. This is Dismantling Colonialism, the Violent Effects of the Doctrine of Discovery on Turtle Island. And so to get started right away, I want to reiterate again and echo the land acknowledgement and the lands that we're on here. This is a picture here of the so-called Sandia Mountains. These mountains are sacred here to the Tiwa people. Again, we are on Tiwa land. And so honor and respect to the ancestors who stewarded these lands and the people today that still continue to steward these lands. Want to acknowledge again too that Pueblo Action Alliance is a woman-led organization, and the women that lead this organization are from these lands. Again, our AD, our Alliance Director, Julia Bernal, is from Sandia Pueblo. And so we always want to highlight that, because it's very rare that you have an organization organizing on the land whose director and organizers are from. And so we want to give an acknowledgement to that. And we also want to acknowledge that the U.S. empire is in fact one of the youngest empires in history, and greater empires have fallen. And therefore, when we say land back, we mean that we are all on stolen land, and that this is not a metaphor when we yell land back and water back. It's a literal statement. And so to get into this presentation, I want to acknowledge that this is coming from an academic perspective. I graduated from UNM this past spring with a bachelor's in religious studies and a minor in peace and justice studies and psychology. And so this is coming strictly from a academic standpoint. I also want to verbalize that a lot of this is inspired by a Dene man named Mark Charles, who does a lot of work in campaigning for the doctrine of discovery. And so a lot of the references and citations at the end of this presentation are coming directly from the research and even the knowledge and understanding and focus that he brings to Indigenous peoples as well. And so to get into it right away, I want to address that we cannot address colonialism without addressing the influence that religion has had on its history. Colonialism and religion are inseparable. And this makes this topic a little bit more uncomfortable than probably most of our conversations regarding decolonial topics. This is gonna be deconstructing a little bit of what colonialism and the settler state has taught us about religion and what that really means, especially for our people here on Turtle Island, and specifically our people in our Pueblo territories. And also I wanted to disclaim that this is not a critique on the church, and this is not a critique on Christianity, but this is history. This is covering history that comes from a non-biased lens. This is history that cannot be erased. And this is something that we need to address within these conversations as well. And so, again, this is not coming from a personal experience. This is coming from studies, and this is coming from a walk within this work of revolutionary work that we are all partaking in as a Pueblo nationalist group and organization. And so by starting off this conversation, we want to talk about the doctrine of discovery. And to just get right into it, the doctrine of discovery is a collection of papal bulls that were written between 1452 and 1493. And these papal bulls right here at the bottom right hand of my screen is an example of a papal bull. And so a papal bull is a type of public decree or charter that was issued by the Pope of the Catholic Church in Europe. And so basically whatever was written on these papal bulls, whatever was written and delivered on these as a decree had a dominion and a say-so over the European nations. And so this was a decree of power and of also supremacy, as we're gonna see coming within this presentation. And so on the left-hand side is a picture of the Doctrine of Discovery, which is the collection again of these papal bulls that were written. And it's basically the church in Europe saying to the nations of Europe that wherever you go and whatever lands you find that are not ruled by white Christian rulers, these people are subhuman and the lands are yours for the taking. And this is the framework that is written down in these ecclesiastical statements, ecclesiastical meaning church. And so this right here, Doctrine of Discovery from 1452, this is a papal bull that Pope Nicholas V wrote. And I'm gonna go ahead and read it verbatim. Invade, search out, capture, vanquish, and subdue all Muslims and pagans whatsoever, and all enemies of Christ wheresoever placed, and the kingdoms, dukedoms, principalities, dominions, and possessions, and all movable and immovable goods whatsoever held and possessed by them, and to reduce their persons to perpetual slavery, and to apply and appropriate to himself and his successors the kingdoms, dukedoms, counties, principalities, dominions, possessions, and goods, and to convert them to his and their use and profit. And so the reason why I bring this up, and this is all, again, this is sourced directly from the doctrine of this specific papal bull and delivered again also by Mark Charles, who works on this. And the traits that are in this papal bull here is literally a framework that fuels the US empire that we live under today. And so an example of that is already the capitalistic mind frame of converting them to his use and their profit, already dehumanizing indigenous and African peoples, already with an elitist philosophy and patriarchy, as it's referenced here, like kingdoms, referring to the power of a male, dukedom, the assistance of power within a patriarchal system. And it's all rooting within slavery and the dehumanization of African and indigenous peoples. And so this doctrine of discovery basically served as a dual function. The first function was that it served as a theological doctrine that served as affirmation from the church for European political and military boundaries. And number two, this doctrine served as a mediation between colonial settler powers. And so this is something, again, that we may not have heard of before, that we don't really talk about in these conversations. And so, yeah, I encourage you to even research and continue even, you know, some of these words that are further written in more of the papal bulls. And so the doctrine of discovery, it first was directed towards Portugal, and then it was directed towards Spain. And so, yeah, the doctrine of discovery basically affirmed that these imperial ambitions could be carried forth by these two European quote unquote powers. And so this picture right here is geared more towards the Spanish conquistadors and the expedition that they intruded on these territories here in what is known as the Southwest. And this is a reminder, this image here, they're not welcome here. This was a picture that was painted. The artist's name is down here, but this is an image that shows like that they are not familiar with the land base that they are on. And this is a historical statement. And so again, to just reiterate, the intent of the doctrine of discovery was to provide a framework for Christian colonizers to lay claim to territories inhabited by Christians. So that basically meant that if the lands were vacant, then they could be sold or defined as discovered and sovereignty claimed, not sold, but discovered and sovereignty claimed. And so this affected the whole world, not just Turtle Island. It didn't just affect here in Tiwa territory. This is the root of resistance in our indigenous organizations globally. And this, it contributes to the resistance of why and what we are resisting to as indigenous organizations and people. And I wanna highlight the Philippines even right now too, and highlight their revolution that took place in 1521. And that was led by Lapu-Lapu, who was the first indigenous Filipino, recognized Phillips, quote unquote Filipino, who resisted Spanish colonization and settler states. He's known for killing Portuguese oppressor Ferdinand Magellan, and that assassination, or that action, that act of revolution, delayed the Spanish occupation to their islands for 40 years. And this is something that we want to highlight, because we're gonna get into more in this topic, we're gonna highlight our 1680 Pueblo Revolt as it relates directly to the Filipino Revolt as well. A whole generation, like 40 years is a whole generation, and that's something to be noted as a revolutionary and as people who are striving for that liberation. And this doesn't just go, and this doesn't stop even with the Philippines and here in Turtle Island, but our relatives in Palestine, our relatives in India, in Brazil, and also in Africa. And so within that, the Portuguese, they took this doctrine of discovery, these ecclesiastical statements, they took these to heart to perpetuate slave trade on African lands, and bringing them to European continents and what is known as North American continent, the lands that are here referred to as Turtle Island. And so the doctrine, it led the Portuguese to legit kill and enslave African and indigenous peoples. This is the same doctrine that Christopher Columbus, when he was in fact lost at sea, quote unquote, apparently discovered, which is bullshit, North America. And so this is an example that when the Christopher Columbus holiday, quote unquote, is acknowledged, it is assuming the dehumanization of indigenous and African peoples. And it continues to. And we cannot stress enough that you cannot discover lands that are already inhabited. You cannot discover lands that are already inhabited. That is called stealing. And in the TED Talk that Mark Charles gives, explaining this part of this discussion, he says, if you don't believe that this is stealing, he said, leave your phones, your wallet, your watches out on the table. I'll come by and discover them for you. You know, right? And so this is the same exact this metaphor, this example is the exact same thing that happened to our lands. This is the U.S. saying to indigenous peoples, by acknowledging this day of Columbus Day, that indigenous and African people are not fully human. And this makes the doctrine of discovery a systematically white supremacist doctrine by assuming the dehumanization of, again, African and indigenous peoples. Furthermore, we see that within these doctrines and these documents, this right here is the Declaration of Independence that was written on July 4th, 1776. This is something that the US, the so-called US, still acknowledges every year on the 4th of July. And within this document, as many of you probably know this, indigenous peoples are referred to as merciless Indian savages. This is something that is uplifted by many of the movements now, the youth movements, also within NTVS, and also Stephen Paul Jude, a couple of indigenous artists who uplift this and try to educate people as to like what this really means and how this these words are rooted within the framework of this government, of this US empire government that we're under. And so along with that same doctrine or the same document in the Declaration of Independence, we are told that all men are created equal. And the reason why this is problematic was because there was a very narrow definition of who was fully human. as per framework by the doctrine of discovery, and as per framework of this Declaration of Independence that that's apparently describes our freedom and rights as human beings. And so the other problematic aspect with this specific document is that women are also excluded. Hence, there are all men are created equal. Women are not included in this statement, and who are actually considered human beings are not referred to as men in this as well. And that makes this document as well a systemically white supremacist document. And this is a document that literally frames our government and all of the laws that come underneath the government here in the US empire that affects every single person. And so furthermore, this is the Constitution. This is another really well-recognized document here underneath the US empire. There are 51 gender-specific pronouns in this document, all of which that are he, him, and his. There's not a single feminine or even non-binary pronoun, right? Everything is referred to for patriarchal setup for the man, for white landowning men. And within the same document, there is the three-fifths clause, which basically explains and describes that Africans are three-fifths human. This is another document that governs the foundation of colonialism, of this system, of what we now know as the US. This makes the Constitution a systemically white supremacist document, just like the Declaration of Independence, as it is frameworked by the doctrine of discovery. And I also encourage everybody to look more also into this, study more into the documents that are founding of our government. This is something that we need to also, as people opposing this hurtful and this systemically racist documents, we also need to be informed of what's in these documents. And by reading them, understanding what the oppressor, what our enemies are thinking when they became, when they stepped foot on these lands. And so, again, to reiterate, these documents were created to protect the interests of white landowning men. They're working, literally, the Constitution is working. The doctrine of discovery framed within the church institution, it's working. Literally, the Declaration of Independence, as it's recognized every year, is working. The reason why we're opposing all of these systematic frameworks is because it is led by this doctrine that already assumed the dehumanization again of our people. And so we cannot be surprised when we have missing and murdered Indigenous women, and nobody turns their head. There's no regard from the government, from the higher ups, of this occurrence happening. And not just missing and murdered Indigenous women, but missing and murdered Indigenous relatives of all ages, of all genders. And so it's not a surprise why women even get paid less than men in this framework of this doctrine, because it excludes women. It's working. And we can't be surprised why prisons are filled with unproportionate numbers of people of color. And that's because these frameworks, this doctrine is working. It's literally set forth by this framework from the European church that came and sent out to harm our people now. And so, yeah, I want to hand it over to Reyes right now to share with us a little bit more on missing and murdered Indigenous relatives and even the New Mexico Task Force as it relates to the doctrine of discovery.
Thank you, Marcus. Also, thank you for sharing all of those mm-hmm. truths and breaking down the information that needs to be heard by everybody. What is happening to our relatives is a heartbreaking epidemic. There are many layers as to why this continues to happen. You know, I would like to acknowledge that we recognize that this violence is not limited to those who identify as she, her. This harm is also inflicted on trans and non-binary relatives. Bottom line, this violence is racist, and it stems from deep-rooted colonial phobic behaviors against Indigenous peoples all across Turtle Island. So today I'll be unpacking how the Doctrine of Discovery in the US Constitution continues to halt justice to victims and their families in the land bases that we organize on. You can go ahead and take it to the next slide, Marcus. So what you're currently looking at is recent data that was collected by, collected here in New Mexico. So it says, according to the 2010 census, New Mexico has the fifth largest Alaskan Indian American, Alaskan Indian Native American population in the US. Yet New Mexico has the highest number of missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls in cases in this country. That's pretty alarming. You know, this is happening in Tiwa territory. Albuquerque sits as one of the top cities, and we have New Mexico's ranked number one of the highest number of missing and murdered Indigenous cases. In 2008, in the Urban Health Institute report, they reported 78 cases. And they, in that report, it's explicitly said that they know that these numbers aren't truly accurate. The numbers could be higher because one of the main challenges that remains here is the legal jurisdiction. The legal jurisdiction of police officers and law enforcement saying, oh no, this isn't my case. This is happening in your county, you take this. And then they just keep passing it on. And unfortunately, these women and all of our relatives and the families, they don't get the justice that they deserve. And we just want to acknowledge, you know, that what this image and this data that you see here right now was also created with the UNM Budget and Policy Institute, UNM Center for Social Policy, and the New Mexico Indian Affairs Department. And the reason why we wanted to share this also because this is in relation to the task force that was created here in New Mexico. So in 2019, Governor Lujan Grisham, with the push from Indigenous voices and people, they established the Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women's Task Force Act. So this House bill created a team of people who would determine the scope of the problem, identify the barriers, and create partnerships to improve the processes of reporting and to, you know, to make sure that we're actually investigating these cases, because like I said, cases just continue to be passed around. What was unique about the task force was that they had representatives from each of the tribal nations. So there was Pueblo, there was Diné, there was Apache people. There was also victims and family members of victims, legal and counseling services. Also Lynn Trujillo, another Tiwa relative of Sandia Pueblo, who's the cabinet secretary for New Mexico Indian Affairs Department. So there are various roles that made up the task force here. And, you know, I would like to, you know, thank the people who work together in this task force, because in reality, this is extremely heavy work. The violence, the stories, just the numbers that we have to look at, and that we know that they're not accurate either. It hurts, you know. And on behalf of PAA, I was represented as a stakeholder, and I also took along our youth interns to also engage and learn in these conversations that were happening. And one of the impacting factors that we're not addressing here is the root of the violence and the root of the violence that comes from these government institutions. Can you go ahead and take it to our next slide, please? So this statement right here says, the settler state government influences the laws and policies through institutions that are guided by white supremacist documents, which allow for missing, murdered, and Indigenous relatives and justices. So basically the Doctrine of Discovery, the Declaration of Independence, the US Constitution, all of these are documents, just as Marcus said, that are still guiding all of these institutions that are creating the laws and policies that continuously oppress us, that don't give us justice and aren't letting us practice any kind of self-determination that we should be allowed to have. And in the state house bill that was created for the task bill, it says the task force shall collaborate with tribal law enforcement agencies to determine the scope of the problem and to identify barriers to address the problem, and then to create partnerships to improve the reporting and the investigation of missing and murdered Indigenous women. But let's be honest here, the US settler government continues to be the problem here. We need to say that out loud as many times as we need to, because it's just truth here. And Marcus did pretty much, you know, kind of explain that, not kind of, he did explain why and how it's working in that way. And so another discriminatory example here is the Violence Against Women Reauthorization Act, also known as the VAWA Act, to combat the missing murdered Indigenous women crisis. The amendments in 2019, which were introduced by Congresswoman Holland, were made to help provide more services that will support victims in urban settings within the state courts. Again, because one of the major issues is legal jurisdiction. You know, if you aren't living in your tribal territories and something were to happen to you, you can't report it. And it's just this really back and forth kind of tangle that needs to be addressed. And so with that, it did get passed, but what I would like to also recognize is that it got held up in Congress. You know, there were representatives there that didn't think that we needed to reauthorize the act or that these amendments needed to be changed. So let us remember, you know, this US settler government that these laws and policies are being created in, whether it's Democrat or Republican, you know, it's not truly there to serve us as a people, because at the end of the day, it was always, you know, dominance of white supremacy and those attempts at genocide. And you ask an Indigenous person today, we still see what's happening to our relatives as attempts of genocide today.
Awesome. Thank you, Reyes, for sharing that information regarding this. The link is in the chat as well. With an infographic to also get more familiarized with missing and murdered Indigenous relatives that are happening all around our tribal communities and within our tribal communities. And so given this information, we have to ask the question, why is the doctrine of discovery important to understand in context of colonial history from specifically an Indigenous perspective? This Indigenous perspective is important as it's directly affecting our communities and our families, our relatives, our friends, our people that are all in the same global struggle. The doctrine of discovery is still a legal precedent that has controls over Native affairs and rights today. This international law that was formulated in these 15th and 16th centuries still controls law and controls how and what happens within our tribal communities today. And an example with that is this court case, which I wanna highlight because this is a case that basically escalates and leads up to the use of the doctrine of discovery. And so in 1998, the Oneida Indian Nation, they purchased their lands, their own traditional lands on the open market. Just like anybody else would. These lands are in what is known now as New York, and they purchased their own traditional land on the open market. The Oneida Indian Nation, they paid full price for these lands. There was no shortcuts. They paid full price for the land that they once had owned, and now at that time had received back. The Oneida Indian Nation wanted to practice full traditional sovereignty over these lands, which means that these lands would not be taxed. And that's as per traditional sovereignty, and it should be acknowledged within this government. The city of Sherrill, which is a city that is near those lands, sued the Oneida Indian Nation for taxing issues because they wanted to tax the tribe. The Oneida Indian Nation won the case at the federal district court, and so the city of Sherrill appealed to the federal court of appeals. Again, the Oneida Indian Nation wins this case again, and so the city of Sherrill appeals to the Supreme Court. In 2005, this court case is heard by the Supreme Court. So within the rulings of this court, right away, the rulings of the lower courts, which the Oneida Nation had won over, are reversed. And that is because the Supreme Court references the doctrine of discovery. They reference this doctrine that, as we've gone over, systematically holds down and dehumanizes Indigenous peoples. And so within this court case is written that given the longstanding, distinctly non-Indian character of the area and its inhabitants, the regulatory authority constantly exercised by New York State and its counties and towns, and the Oneida's long delay in seeking judicial relief against the parties other than the United States, we hold that the tribe cannot unilaterally revive its ancient sovereignty in whole or in part. And the wording of this, the fact that it is highlighting and using the word ancient sovereignty, referring something as ancient as if it never existed under government rule, or if it never existed under a rule of people, of societies. And so by assuming that this is ancient sovereignty, it's stripping already the Oneida Indian Nation away from their rights to govern themselves on their traditional lands that were stolen, and to completely not be possible to revive from that sovereignty. And so moving forward, this court has recognized the impracticability of returning to the Indian control land that generations earlier passed into numerous private hands. The court continues, it is impossible to resign the cession and restore the Indians to their former rights because the lands have been open to settlement and large portions of them are now in possession of innumerable innocent purchasers. These lands have been open to settlement is referring to white settlement, and the fact that they're referring these purchasers as innocent numerous purchasers are already assuming again that there was no that there was a compromise basically in history of these lands, and it's again acknowledging the dehumanization of the people that govern these lands, and also incorporates the capitalist philosophies that are also grounded within these lands. And so moreover, the properties here involved have greatly increased in value since the Oneidas sold them 200 years ago. This is verbatim words that are coming straightly from this court case. Notably, it was not until lately that the Oneidas sought to regain ancient sovereignty over lands converted from wilderness. Land converted from wilderness to become parts of cities like Sherrill. And so the fact that these lands are spoken of as greatly increasing in value already is again, just it's ignoring the tribal sovereignty the Oneida tribe has over these lands and continues to have over these lands. The term wilderness also is dehumanizing to the land and is dehumanizing to the people who govern these lands and who steward these lands based off of the definition of wilderness, referring to these lands as something that was not governed or tamed or respected at one point in time. Any land that was considered wilderness was considered something that was not already being governed on. And so this is, again, referring to the framework of doctrine of discovery. We go into the conclusion that in the court case where they stated that we now reject the unification theory of the Oneida Indian Nation and the United States and uphold the standards of federal Indian law and federal equity practice preclude the tribe from rekindling embers of sovereignty that long ago grew cold. These standards of federal Indian law are framed from doctrine of discovery. This doctrine of discovery it led this case, it helped decide this case in terms of who is going to walk out of there with their land and who's going to win. This case is based off of the framework of the doctrine of discovery. And it was written and delivered by Ruth Bader Ginsburg, this liberal hero that that is looked up to. This case was delivered by this person. And we can't forget that this court case is probably one of the most white supremacist court cases in the Supreme Court, probably in most of our lifetimes. And so we have to ask the question again, you know, why is the doctrine of discovery important now to understand in the context of colonial history from a Pueblo indigenous perspective? To answer that, it's because our colonial story here on our Pueblo lands is similar but different from the rest of Turtle Island. There are a few reasons for that too, and as we mentioned earlier, it is because of the 1680 Pueblo Revolt as to why we have a different colonial story, colonial history from our relatives in Turtle Island. The Spanish language, like English, is the oppressive language, is the language of our oppressors here in Pueblo territories. And that's an example. We get like the term Albuquerque, the word Albuquerque, Bernalillo, we have like Oñate, right? Espanola, these are all examples of Spanish influence on our Pueblo territories. And there has to be acknowledgement of these truths, because there is a lot of misunderstanding of this colonial history that took place here and that continues to take place here in our Pueblo communities. And that goes along with the narrative of the term Hispanic, as you know, Hispanic was a term that was created and during the colonization of indigenous peoples on the what is now called the South border, and it erases indigenous identities. The term Hispanic erases indigenous identities. It is a term that assumes that Spanish colonizers were here and they, by taking this land and by killing and raping and reproducing with our people, that they would identify themselves as something other than Spanish. And that is something that we also have to address. And this is something that we also have to push forward on, because the study of critical race theory is important for us to continue on in work of organizing and in work of revolutionary mindsets. It's something that people, you know, that we overlook when we think about race and history and what comes with those identities and how those identities can often be harmful to indigenous peoples and African peoples. And so we even have like the term Pueblos, right? Like the term Pueblo is literally a Spanish word, but we always acknowledge that the Europeans the Spaniards never bothered to learn our indigenous languages. Just like the rest of Turtle Island, the Portuguese and the Spanish never bothered to learn our indigenous languages. So we have to learn their languages. We have to learn Spanish. Our ancestors had to learn English and Spanish to be able to continue lifeways, to be able to survive by force. And so as we reclaim this oppressive language that we all must speak now, we have to use the words Pueblo, right, to unify as a people, as an indigenous movement, to reclaim these lands back, to reclaim our identities back. And so we have to continue to remember that we can't erase that Spanish colonizers were motivated by this doctrine of discovery to justify killing, raping, and destroying our people in lands of our Pueblo territories. This is something that we cannot ignore. As hard as it is to say and as hard as it is to address, we have to continue to understand the history of why we are where we are right now. And the narrative and time in history, this will forever affect our people. This constant identity shift will always affect our Pueblos and our communities and our youth and the elders that have gone before us. And so This is just a small example. This is just a picture by Jason Garcia from Capo, Santa Clara Pueblo. And this is to reiterate again that the history that takes place here in our pueblos will affect us and for later generations as to why we have generational trauma in our communities, why there is mental health and genetic issues that happen because of this traumatic history, something that we have to acknowledge. And so tying this back to the Pueblo Revolt, the core of our resistance was to liberate the people from Spanish rule. It was to liberate our people from religious persecution that was fueled by the doctrine of discovery. And this history is rooted again, and these are examples here in so-called New Mexico on Pueblo territories that are trickles of this history that still exists today. This is a picture of the Oñate statue that finally came down after how many years of remembrance of genocide this statue stood for. Another example is the town of Bernalillo. When you're driving in from our northern Tiwa and Karis territories, that you see this coming into Tiwa territory. This is a picture of the conquistador helmet. This is acknowledging that this is a city of an oppressor, someone who killed and raped our people on these lands. Down here is the seal from the University of New Mexico, an institution that organizes on stolen land and by further acknowledges the genocide of indigenous peoples by allowing these symbols of conquistadors to be on this seal. And this is a seal, this is something that has been on diplomas, that has been on letterheads, that has been on these official documents that come out of this institution that represent the genocide, the mass genocide and killing of indigenous people, here specifically to Pueblo people. I think right now it's like on a standstill because it's trying to be the youth right now, the youth-led movements on campus are trying to abolish this, you know, but that's also a fight in itself. This picture here, again, this is a picture that was taken in Farmington, and this is a sacred symbol, right? The Zia symbol that is sacred to some of our people, our Pueblo people, that has been used for a symbol of white supremacy. And even the symbol of what is known as the swastika was already stolen from indigenous symbolism and significance. And so this image here is an example of that allowing to happen, of the Doctrine of Discovery's framework in the US Constitution and the Declaration of Independence literally allowing this to happen. This image down here is again in the institution of University of New Mexico. It's called the Three Peoples Mural. And this mural right here basically is saying that there's only three races here in New Mexico, and that is the white man, the Native American, and the quote unquote Hispanic. And so within these murals, it shows like as if there was a settlement again or an agreement on how these lands were stolen and taken. In the first image, there is a picture of indigenous governments, and then the next image there's a symbol of slavery, and as it goes in more depth of the church being built, down here you have white settlers, as if it's saying that we didn't know how to bring these things here to these lands, as if these technologies were brought here for the better. And then in this last image you see the sandias in the background, and you have this agreement, the symbolism of agreement, as if this took place, and this never took place. This is not agreed on by historians, and this is not agreed on by our indigenous communities. This is a racist mural that has yet to be taken down in Zimmerman Library on the UNM campus. Furthermore, there's examples of even Coronado Center. Everyone who's been in Tiwa territory knows Coronado Center. It's literally named after a conquistador who led an expedition here to again conquer and kill our peoples. There's Columbus Park that is downtown, near Central here in Tiwa territory. There's Kit Carson Park and Kit Carson National Forest, who was the person who led the long walk in killing the Diné people, and not just Diné people. And these lands are on the territories of Taos Pueblo, Picaris Pueblo, and also Apache territory. And so these are literally examples of how this is accepted, and this is still trickling down as acceptance in our state, our quote unquote state. the old Duke's logo as well, has perpetuated racism against indigenous peoples by also symbolizing mass genocide. And you hear a lot of fans, a lot of people, and you'll see them wearing this logo, and it's, you know, they say, oh, this is Duke City, you know, and dukedom was literally a word that was used in the papal bull from Pope Nicholas V. This is literally an example of a symbol that was brought from those lands to these lands to kill. And then lastly, this is a picture of the church that sits near the plaza in what is known as Santa Fe, on our northern Tijuana Pueblo's territory. And this was built and forced by Spanish colonizers for indigenous people to build this in light of the genocide that took place. And so the removal of European occupation and the resurgence of indigenous identities is at heart of this work. Decolonization, when we talk about decolonizing, when we talk about reclaiming, we mean the removal of European occupation and the resurgence of indigenous identities. We must understand what is here that influences us from a European perspective that was driven by this framework of the doctrine of discovery. And we must understand how to move in this way that we can reclaim our identities back and resurge those identities as indigenous peoples. And it's something that we are constantly working at now. And this is the definition that Pueblo Action Alliance goes by in terms of decolonization. And so again, tying this back to the Pueblo Revolt, all of these images are by Jason Garcia, again, from Capo. And this is, you know, again, the core of our resistance was to drive out religious persecution from our pueblos. And to liberate our people from this persecution as well. And that was all fueled by this white supremacist doctrine. And so we think about the pueblos now, and these are some of the images of the churches that exist right now within some of our homelands. This includes all of the Christian sects, like Methodist, Presbyterian, Catholic, Baptist. Like, these are all of these sects derived from this doctrine of discovery that was brought here as to why these churches exist. And it has a forced place on our pueblos. These institutions have a forced place there through history, as we just went through. But in order to continue, in order for our people to continue their life ways during the time of revolution, they had to adapt, which meant incorporating some of these ways. They had to continue and keep their traditional ways, but also adapt to this Catholic paradigm that was forced on them. Today, though, we see the youth. We see the youth that is going against Catholic paradigms, that is refuting the church, that is refuting these systems and these doctrines that are continuing to oppress them and their ancestors. We have the resources and the internet to understand now what a doctrine of discovery is. We have the understanding now to go and look up what these documents say, what these documents mean. We can translate these documents. And so now we see the youth actively refuting the church empire, which is an institution that is rooted in white supremacy and colonization. And in doing so, we remember 1680 while doing that, as the exact same actions that took place by our ancestors on these lands of driving out Spanish occupation is the exact same motivation as revolutionary people today. And so by remembering 1680, this incorporates suffocating the oppressive institutions that are in our spaces that don't only harm Pueblo people, but that harm people of color. And not just here in Tijuana territory or on Pueblo territory, but from all directions, north, south, east, and west of Turtle Island, and even across the seas, across the ocean. And so refusing this doctrine of discovery-driven framework, this doctrine of discovery, it means being educated and understanding that the government, the church, the institutions that were created to exclude people of color are rooted in that framework. And so by decolonizing means removing that from our spaces, being rooted to our ways and understanding how we can move forward that allows more humanization and more resurgence of identities of African peoples, of indigenous peoples, of people of color, of our queer relatives, our LGBTQIA plus relatives, everybody who is hurt by this doctrine. We continue to be educated. We have to continue to be equipped with this understanding and knowledge of what we are facing. And so with that, I want to say that it is our time. It is our time as Indigenous peoples. It is a time for the youth to rise and be knowledgeable in this history, for us to continue the work that we are doing with Public Action Alliance, along with the other organizations that are surrounding and organizing here on Tiwa territory and beyond. And so, yeah, I wanna end kind of a little bit with the statement that Black Lives Matter on Tiwa territory and 1682 Infinity. We will continue to do this work, and we will continue to educate, to liberate, because the liberation of Indigenous peoples is the liberation for all. And so I wanna end, these are some of the sources and the references that we used in this presentation. It's the We the People, the TED Talk that Mark Charles gave, and also his book called Unsettling Truths, The Ongoing Dehumanization and Legacy of the Doctrine of Discovery. We reference our website at the beginning and some of our framework as well. And then here are some of the references that were mentioned by Reyes in Missing and Murdered Indigenous People content. And so these sources are here as well. And yeah, I want to leave a space for Reyes if you wanted to share anything.
Thank you, Marcus, especially if, you know, just ending us on that note, you know, that's a good reminder. Because we know that this work is not easy. We know that it is heavy. But again, like I said in the beginning, we do this because it's our life work. You know, we acknowledge that we carry this revolutionary spirit within us, and Indigenous peoples also recognize that we come from a bloodline of people who have always resisted. You know, there have maybe been times where we have felt defeated, or our ancestors felt defeated, but like they kept going, you know, and they kept fighting because they were wanting to envision a future for us, you know, to be able to live and to thrive in our communities and our own land bases. And I'd also like to acknowledge, you know, like, thank you for everyone for participating today and, you know, deconstructing the learning, you know, that we've been taught. That's the core root of the way that we can liberate our people, you know, educate to liberate. You know, we must unlearn all the things that have been placed upon us, you know, and we must continuously share any time that we learn something new that may have challenged our original ways of thinking, or those colonial lies that have been taught to us, and just share the truths that we know and that aren't present in our history books. You know, it takes the people to liberate the people, you know, and we thank you for joining us today. This is an image created by Marcus as well. You know, we need to liberate Turtle Island. We need to make sure that and remind our people that that we are going to be liberated one day. There will be like another revolution. It will happen. It might not be in our lifetime, but it needs to happen, you know, for our Earth Mother to heal. And, you know, we definitely do this on a grassroots level. We're continuously learning and looking back on how we can include more of our Pueblo Indigenous voices. So I thank you all for joining, and yeah, thank you to our team members. I see them dropping in the chat. If anybody would like to support our work and what we're doing, please feel free. So feel free to do that. Go check out our website. We have lots of other campaigns that are happening, the Water Back campaign, also our mutual aid efforts. That last image that Marcus shared with the trucks, that was on Indigenous Peoples Day. And we are continuously helping our unsheltered relatives right now, you know, again, because this pandemic has disproportionately impacted our peoples. And again, you know, it's because like government is not respecting our livelihood. Therefore, you know, we have to come together and practice this community defense model to make sure that we're going to take care of our people. But I would, you know, like to provide a little bit of space if anybody would like to just share takeaways and what they learned here, or if there are ways that, you know, their learning was deconstructed here a little bit today before we kind of end off here. So yeah, please feel free to drop that in the chat as well. We thank you. This is definitely one of our largest number of participants in one of our workshops. So thank you. And our links for our website to learn more about what we're doing are in the chat, and you can follow publicactionalliance.org.
Yeah, just to reiterate too, thank you all for taking the time to just join us in this discussion, and just join us in our walk also of liberating ourselves by educating ourselves. And so yeah, if there's anybody that would like to share a reflection piece, feel free to. If not, that's totally fine. I think we'll wait a couple of minutes and then we'll sign off. Yeah, thank you, ma'am, for dropping that in the chat. They said, I felt like a lot of dots were connected with the doctrine of discovery, like how it still shows up, land theft through the guise of eminent domain to steal natural occurring life forces like oil, metals, et cetera. Yeah, it's a really good point. Thank you, ma'am, for pointing that out and connecting to our current political battles with elements of our sacred earth, our mother, who holds these sacred metals, these substances that she creates, and bringing that into light of how that is continuing to be stolen and continuing to be colonized as per doctrine of discovery.
Connecting the dots is kind of where it really begins, you know, connecting the dots and beginning to kind of piece it all together, you know, because it's systemic, you know, all of it from the very beginning, since Spanish colonizers set foot, you know, since the doctrine of discovery, you know, it's always been a frame, their own framework to dominate and to colonize the peoples. And we must continue to remember that even though these documents are ancient, we're seeing them in all these subtle, not subtle, covert ways. And we hope that, you know, each of you continue to dive deep into educating yourself, but not just yourself, but those around you. You know, that's what it also takes as well, figuring out how you can begin to have these conversations with your own relatives, with your own circles, because that's also where it starts. We need to make sure that we're always providing accessible information to our people and breaking it down, you know, because a lot of this information, if you were to go look it up and research it, you know, on the internet or somewhere, it won't be broken down the way that Marcus did today. So I want to thank you again, Marcus, for sharing your knowledge and diving deep and deconstructing this with us today. Sure. And thank you all.
Julia in the chat says that if you all would like to send your reflections also, like later on, you can feel free to send them to PuebloActionAlliance@gmail.com. That's our organization email. We read them and check up on those as well. So feel free to do that. Yami Lucero says, thank you for your work. Thank you, Yami, for coming on and joining us. Damiana, yes, this will be recorded, or this is recorded and will be posted on our streaming platforms, both on YouTube and on Facebook under Pueblo Action Alliance. And so, yeah, you can access this later along with our other op-ed and workshops that we've done in the past. So all of those are on our YouTube. You can access some of them on our website, PuebloActionAlliance.org. And you can also access them on our Instagram and Facebook. Zachary Kahn says, retweet. Louise says, it's really interesting to see the modern legacies of colonization down to the name of the mall to a park. It's so insidious. Have to keep our eyes open no matter what. Yeah, stay woke. Julia Bernal. Yes. Oh, yeah. Answering the mania. Damiana, apologies if I mispronounce your name. Charisse, going through this workshop, it made me realize how much I need to unlearn. Yeah, that's a really good point. We are all constantly deconstructing and unlearning these ways that colonialism has forced upon us. It's something that we were born into, and therefore we have to really unlearn things that we were born into, especially under an oppressive empire. Thank you for sharing that, Charisse. Ciao, ciao. Thank you, Natalie says, thank you for your time and energy in creating and sharing this. And thank you, Natalie, for being here. Please stay safe and healthy. Thank you, Carlene says, thank you for PAA, especially Marcus. I realize that this will not happen in my lifetime and probably not in my children's either. As I teach my children their Pueblo ways, this also has to be an integral part of their teaching so that this gets passed down from generation to generation. Yeah, that's so important. Mm-hmm. Our generations, this work is for our later generations. It's for the future of the people, of our youth that come before us, even the ones we're not gonna be able to meet. We wanna hopefully set up that experience and that and the traditional life ways that we still hold today for the people, our people who are yet to come. And so, that's what this work is all about. Thank you, Carlene, for sharing that. Zachary says, I had no idea the doctrine of discovery existed or was used as such a big precedent for all of this. Super informative. Thank you very much. Yeah, it's surprising. A few years ago when I first heard about the doctrine of discovery, again, presented by Mark Charles at a conference, it really challenged a lot of what we were told, right? Our beliefs. And a lot of that colonial history is connected to our beliefs. And sometimes that belief can be confused and even connected to spirituality, or what we're told is spirituality. And then it could end up being harmful. And so I'm glad that this was educational for you, and that, mm-hmm. you know, I hope you continue to research.
Yeah. And I'm sure, like, you know, there needs to be time to decompress, you know, a lot of reflections will continue to come forth, you know, in the days to come and in your learning and unlearning that you do for yourselves. And yeah, like we said, if you want to share any of those reflections, you can do that by sending them to our email, publicactionalliance@gmail.com. We are getting close to wrapping up our time, and we want to, again, Debanopa, thank you. Thank you for being here, for participating with us. And again, this is recorded. So at any point in time, you can look at it again. It's going to be uploaded onto our YouTube channel. So yeah, thank you again. Thank you, Marcus. Thank you everyone for being here.
Yep. Yeah, thank you. Reading the comments and we acknowledge everything, all the input. And yeah, thank you all for engaging in this time of reflection. And we just want to send everybody out with, you know, just be safe and continue to look out for each other, especially in our communities of color, you know. Just look out for one another and have each other's backs. We send blessings to everybody. And yeah, we're going to go ahead and sign out now. Again, feel free to send us more to our email or connect with us even on our personal social media accounts. I'll definitely answer those as well. Just want to acknowledge just reading the different comments and inputs too from our chat. Thank you all for sharing, and